firewall because we're bringing you breaking news for church and what's happening in the United States. We've been interviewing Pastor Cheon, whose church has gone through a horrific battle themselves, where members in the church were basically being set up to be arrested and fined $1,000 for every church service they went to. And it's kind of hard to believe that a governor would do that. But Pastor Che, the city prosecutor also, I mean, we're just learning that you vote on these things and you don't think about a judge or a prosecutor. But when you have a weaponized ideological world out there that doesn't like us, it makes a big difference when you've got a city prosecutor targeting the church. I mean, that's the first time you've had that happen in all the years you've been in Pasadena. Is that right?
Absolutely. But, you know, it's been California, as you know, is the most progressive left state of any other state. And I believe it's a socialist state. And socialism, the whole philosophy behind that is that government controls, the government dictates. And the reason why they hate the church so much is because we answer to a higher authority instead of the state, and that's Jesus Christ. Jesus is the head of the church. And so when we felt scripturally that we should continue to meet as a church on Pentecost Sunday, May 31st, that's when we got the hate mails and emails, even from the community. People said, you're killing your church members and you're being selfish. By the way, just a side note, we've not had one COVID case with our church members or with our staff. We test every month as a staff. We have 40 of our staff, and we've all just been tested. And the reason why is because it's not like throwing things out the window. We mitigate. We tell people with who are high risk, those with underlying conditions, stay home and watch online. We also tell people to wear your mask as you come in. Now, they could take it off during worship, just like at a restaurant, you know, you could take it off when you come in. But we encourage everyone to spread out. We have a beautiful, large auditorium, and so we make sure that there's enough spacing taking place. And so we take people's temperature, but even with that, we ask, would you like to have your temperature taken? If they say no, there's freedom, and we don't want to dictate. Whereas the government is, as you know, this Thanksgiving said you had to be outdoors for your Thanksgiving dinner, no more than two households together, and you have to wear your mask in between bites. They are so micromanaging. It's all about control. It's really a manifestation of a socialist philosophy.
And I think that we're just now catching on. I really believe that the people in America, like the church itself, doesn't understand what's happening. And this idea that socialism is really when an elite is running the world and the people are like the bricks in the Tower of Babel. They're no longer allowed to have their own shape and do their own thing. They have to conform and be put in place. And like you said, this is why communism and dictators have to shut down the church and media, because freedom of speech and the right to assemble and worship are direct threats to government tyranny. And we're literally watching a nation moving in the direction of a tyranny they do not realize they're empowering. But you're the front lines of that. What was it like, honestly, for you as a pastor? There really is a question of courage involved in this, isn't there? Because I noticed there weren't that many churches in California that were willing to open. They were willing to kind of sit it out and ride the storm. But I mean, there really is a persecution. You're the front lines of those that are hitting it. And we're just so happy, so proud of the fact that you stood against it. But what's it like? What do pastors need to know about this that you've learned?
Well, I don't want to condemn anyone, but the truth is we have the largest evangelical number of believers in California, only next to Texas. In the whole United States, we have so many mega churches, and I could count on really one hand of the pastors that have stood, like John MacArthur. He's probably the most well-known, but there are others. And it's amazing because I was hoping if we had thousands of churches and pastors who had their own building, have in-person service, I think they could have made a statement to the governor that we are essential and that we are not going to tolerate this oppressive, unconstitutional edict. But that didn't happen. And so we have to take a stand. And I felt from the Lord that we need to be prophetic in this situation. We need to take a prophetic stand. And we need to send a signal that we believe that Jesus is the head of the church, and we're not answering to a governor, but to, or Caesar, so to speak, but to our Lord Jesus Christ. And he has mandated that we worship him in spirit and in truth. And so we're doing it for his glory, for his honor. But there's also 51 others that he puts in the Bible that you cannot do online. The most basic one is to greet one another. So we greet each other with a chicken wing, you know, but nevertheless, we greet each other. And so this is so important that we not forsake the assembling of the saints, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. I could give so many other commandments and verses, but I think you get the point.
Yeah, and I think there's something more to this neglect not the assembling of yourselves together than we think, because there's something about the power of the community of saints coming together. Their corporate worship actually has an effect, their corporate prayer, their corporate alignment. And you almost could correlate the fact that when we have the shutdowns, remember, we had 100 cities in turmoil with riots and such. And one pastor said to me, have you ever thought about the territorial impact of what happens when millions of Christians gather together in unity and worship God and pray? And what happens when they are not doing that, and how it literally does, it leaves almost a vacuum in the spiritual atmosphere of our cities. And cities have atmospheres. As you said, your state, California, and we always look at New York. I talked for years about sheep and goat nations, and I'm kind of educating people still in the fact that geography and culture and nations actually take on a disposition of whatever spirits are over them. That's why Michael and Gabriel were warring against the prince of Persia in the book of Daniel. And we're learning that over cities and states, there's an atmosphere also. And California has a history of revival from Azusa Street to the Jesus movement. And I can't help but think that what's going to happen next is an awakening to the church in California that is going to rise up. And you said something interesting before we took a break. You're seeing this as being a precursor to what's happening nationally, because what happened with this last election is like the same spirit of lawlessness by fiat. You're going to do what we want you to do, whether the facts are there or not, and you're going to accept it because this is reality. But really, this court case is an indication that we do now have justices that aren't necessarily willing to roll over when it comes to the freedoms that Americans have.
Yeah, absolutely. And Lance, you were the one that encouraged me, just going back to about hosting the Holy Spirit in our city, because we had 3 years of nightly meetings, five nights a week, from 1996 to 1999. And it's amazing what happened in our city during that time, because when you come together to worship, the Bible says he inhabits the praises of his people. We saw the crime rate drop from number one in L.A., per capita, by the way, in Pasadena, because of the gang wars between the Bloods and the Crips, to being the most peaceful city. The whole old Pasadena, today, if you come to old Pasadena's high-end restaurants and stores, but it was the red light district where prostitutes hung out, adult bookstore. You can't find that anywhere. But, you know, people were saying, I would say that, and people say, well, that's anecdotal. This is just coincidence. But you encouraged me, said, no, those are signs of transformation. And probably the biggest thing we saw is that there was a cult named Worldwide Church of God, founded by Herbert Armstrong. And we prayed for this cult for years because we knew that, you know, they were headquarters right here in Pasadena. And sure enough, Armstrong dies. His successor is only leading it for another 6 months, and he dies. And the third successor becomes born again. And so revival breaks out in their movement, but it was like a Gideon's revival. They went from 300,000 worldwide down to 30,000, and they had to sell their property. And this is my Kim Clement story. Kim came out to our church, and he prophesied. He said, you guys are ambassadors, and I believe that God's going to give you a building named Ambassador. Well, we purchased the Ambassador Auditorium, which is a crown jewel of Pasadena. It's a $32 million beautiful building we got for one-third of the price and bought it in 2004. So we've seen so much transformation because of hosting the Holy Spirit.
That's such an amazing story, the Ambassador Auditorium. And indeed, I mean, this is probably the most beautiful and stately church structure in the United States. I mean, I've seen episodes of like television shows that have been filmed there, and I keep telling my wife, that's Jay's church, because I see
serve our community by having them share. But what people may not know is we share the gospel before every shooting of a television show, movie. Like Dreamgirls was shot in our auditorium, and we shared with Beyonce, every crew, Academy Award winning choreographer. We shared the gospel. We did that several times when they were shooting in our building, and it was part of the contract. Before each concert, Pasadena Symphony uses our, that we would, normally would be me. I would get up, but there were so many events that now we have other people do it, or now we put it in print that this building is to the glory of God, and that is our honor to serve our city by opening it up because of the words of Jesus. He said, I came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And there you have the gospel of his laying down his life for us because of his love for us, and of course, rising from the dead. And so what a privilege to have this building to share the gospel. And we've seen people come to know the Lord, become part of our church. We had two violinists from an orchestra get saved and added to our church as a result of this outreach.
Well, I read something recently regarding statistics on shutdowns in business, but there's also 1 out of 5 churches because they haven't been able to meet. Not everybody has a web presence, and so 1 out of 5 churches is estimated to be closing down over the next couple of months, as well as these businesses. And but I think that many of these pastors are going to discover that the church was never a building in the first place. In your case, the embassy auditorium is appropriate because of what your message and your anointing is. But how could many of these churches and pastors align with someone like you, who is obviously in an apostolic frontline capacity? Those that are struggling, those that are looking for leadership, how can they connect with someone like you in your organization to be part of the strength of assembling together?
Well, you know, we're one of many apostolic networks that God has raised up really since the 90s. You know, when I think of Partners in Harvest with John Arnott and Global Awakening with Randy Clark and Bill Johnson, Global Legacy, these are all apostolic networks that were not in existence before 1990. And Harvest International Ministry is the one that I have the privilege of leading. We are in 70 nations. We stopped counting. Peter Wagner was my mentor, my apostle, and he always wanted me to count how many churches. We stopped counting after 25,000 churches around the world. It was just getting ridiculous because of the growth of the church in the developing nations. But we have 162 churches just in California alone, and they're all part of the plaintiff suing Governor Newsom. So it's not just Harvest Rock Church. We have some more churches behind the scenes suing Governor Newsom, putting more teeth to our lawsuit. So they can contact, it's all about him, HIM, Harvest International Ministry. And they could go online and shows how they can become a member. But you're absolutely right. You know, we have a lot of churches that don't have their own building in our network. And they're meeting at home. They're watching on me on stream. Many of the pastors are also going online. They have Zoom services. There's so many creative things that we have been doing. The main thing is that the ecclesia, the called out ones, are people, and that you can't stop that. I will build my church, my ecclesia, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. In fact, during this COVID, we've grown the most. We planted 3 separate satellite congregations, campuses in Riverside, in Orange County, in downtown LA. And it's amazing that even when I encourage people to stay home, because if I said, listen, if you come, we got a letter from our city prosecutor, you will be arrested and you will be fined $1,000. Now, we said we'll cover your fine, but we can't guarantee you not being arrested, and we can't do anything about that until we get an injunction, which we did. But the point being is that the next week, more people showed up. And so I believe that we're going through an awakening, and I do believe that God's reviving and awakening churches that are taking a stand for his honor, for his kingdom purposes. And so I really want to encourage that for pastors to really pray about having in-person service. And right now, because we won the case against our city prosecutor, I can promise you, you will not be arrested or fined for a meeting.
Well, Pastor Jay, thank you for your testimony. Thank you for the update. And I know that there are people all over the place that are dialing in on this story right now and realizing both the urgency of the hour and the importance of righteousness in the courts and government, right on down to the city prosecutors and governors. There's an awakening, and I think it's a civic awakening for Christians also, that God gave us authority, that we need to use the authority that we have so that we can protect the freedoms that we have. Thank you once again for being part of our special broadcast, Pastor.
Thank you, Lance. Love you. Bless you. Look forward.